instances are represented by features. And as far as this learning algorithm goes, and as far as the hypothesis goes, the only interface that it has, these algorithms have to instances, is through these features. And we looked at this problem called overfitting, where you basically, in a very loose way, you end up remembering the training set. And you never generalize. And there's the problem of curse of dimensionality. I hope you guys remember, we saw some pretty counterintuitive examples in the last lecture. And the curse of dimensionality simply says, high dimensional space is a very scary space. And you don't want to always generalize things that you have in two or three dimensions to n-dimensional space for large n, because distances don't behave in the same way. Any questions about this broad, basically checkpoint of where we are? Yes.
So when we're talking about generalization, I was thinking of staying in the same dimension and just kind of guess a function that predicts some labels or stuff like that, but in the same dimension. So, how we mean by generalization? I mean, there should be two things. For example, when you're just having same features and just try to, for example, we see some examples and then we generalize that.
So how does the nearest neighbor's algorithm generalize? The nearest neighbor's algorithm, if you get a new example that it has never seen before, what's the inductive bias? It simply says, given one point which has a label, its immediate neighborhood has the same label. That's how you generalize. You go from one point to a collection of points. You are able to predict a label for a point that you've never seen before. That is the generalization that happens in nearest neighbors. In decision trees, how does it generalize? You basically say that you break down the decision, the label, into a series of questions, really, one for each node. And instead of looking at this particular record having this label, you break it down column-wise. And the reason this generalizes is because you might see new examples which share some of these columns, some values, not the exact same record, but something that's similar enough, and you'll get the same label. So you are able to make predictions for inputs that you've never seen before. But we'll talk about generalization in more detail, probably even in the next lecture. And let's hold on to that thought. We'll talk about a more mathematical definition of generalization. But today's lecture is actually an introduction to a new hypothesis class called linear classifiers. We just started looking at it in the previous lecture. I'm just going to redo the thing. And we'll talk about what are linear classifiers. And I'll try to convince you that linear classifiers are a fairly expressive hypothesis class. There are many functions that it can express. And then we'll take a detour from classification to regression. As many of you might have seen regression before. If you haven't, we're going to go through it in gory details, so don't worry. The reason we'll go through regression is because a lot of ideas in training classifiers can be traced back mathematically to the way we do linear regression. So a lot of patterns that we'll see for training look very similar to the way things happen in the regression universe. And then finally, I'm planning to end today's lecture with just a broad overview of this land of linear classifiers, which talks about algorithms like perceptron, Winnow, SVM, and all those things. So let's start off with linear classifiers. I think in the first or second lecture, we looked at this example that said, it's impossible to learn a complex Boolean function because the search space is huge. You just cannot iterate through every Boolean function because there are 2 power n Boolean functions, and there is no way we can hope to even cover that search space. So what was the answer? How could we possibly learn anything?
You have to limit the hypothesis space.
You have to limit the hypothesis space. You limit the search space. And what you do is you come up with a guess. You say, I believe the target function, the concept, is not an arbitrary Boolean function, it's not an arbitrary function, but is an element of this much, much smaller set. And we worked through a couple of examples, conjunctions and M of N rules, where we saw basically just by enumerating every possible conjunction, we can just check if it agrees with the data, and we can try to find something. And the smaller we make the search space, the faster we can find something, find a hypothesis. And the game that we want to play is to come up with a hypothesis space that is expressive enough, that can actually contain most functions that we might want to care about, and yet is easy to search. Okay? And what I'm going to claim is that the linear classifier is one such space. It's expressive enough to represent many Boolean functions, and yet search is easy because we are no longer in this discrete search space. We can use everything that we know from continuous optimization, numerical methods, and the weird fact of life is very often search over discrete spaces can be computationally more difficult than search over continuous spaces. And we'll take advantage of that for learning. But we'll come to that. But before that, this is where we stop. Say we're given some training data. We want to separate the triangles from the circles. And I'm going to show you two classifiers. One of them is a curve, A, which manages to perfectly separate this data and puts all the triangles on one side and the circles on the other side. The other one is a line, which might show up if I click again. Yes. And the line doesn't do all that great of a job. It makes a few mistakes. It puts a few things in the wrong side. But I'm going to claim that the line is actually better than the curve. Why?
Simpler to develop.
It's simpler to develop, yes. But there's a more, there's another reason. Last row.
The curve is the modeling most.
Yes. You might end up overfitting the training set. You might, the curve might end up, as you say, modeling the noise, and you want a training, you want a hypothesis which doesn't overfit the noise. This idea is actually fairly old. You can make a similar argument for regression. Say you have a collection of points, and I want to find, so I want to find a function f of x which approximates these points. There's no separation, I just want the function value. Remember, classification is about predicting one of a discrete set. Regression is about predicting a real value. And I could fit a curve that gets the whole thing, or I can try to find a line. Now, if I have a collection, a finite set of points, there exists a polynomial for any collection of points that is of high enough degree that will that basically contains all these points. Does this mean it's a good thing to have that polynomial? No, because there is always noise in your data. You don't want to fit to the noise. And one way of being robust to noise is actually to make some mistakes during training, which might seem weird. Any questions about, at this point we are only talking intuition, but questions? Okay, let's define linear classifier. The inputs are high dimensional or n dimensional vector. I'll fix this eventually and start calling the dimensionality d. I'll change this slide later on. The input's a vector, a real value vector, and the output is a plus 1 or a minus 1. Sometimes I'll say the output is a 0 or 1, and you see both of these things in the literature, think of it as one is true and zero is false, or one is true and minus one is false. So a linear classifier is a machine, a box, that takes a vector x and produces a true or a false, spam or not spam. These are also called linear threshold units because they are defined in this following way. The output is defined to be the sine of some score assigned to this input. And the score is simply a line. You have an input x, you take the dot product of x with a weight vector w, w is a parameter to this object, add a threshold, add a bias term b, and take the sine of it. What that means is, equivalently, given an input x, I compute w dot x plus b, I call that the score. If the score is positive, I predict true. If the score is negative, I predict false. Questions about the linear threshold unit? And we'll be looking at this quite a bit, I think, for about the next month or so. And we'll look at many, many different algorithms that learn linear threshold units. Here, X's are your features. In, for example, the badges data, X's, the X could be a vector representing whatever features you guys have invented. And W is a score which assigns, because it's a dot product, it assigns one real valued score for every feature. And there is a bias which is always there, B, and that's the score for your input. There is a neat geometric intuition for this, and I'm going to plot it in two dimensions and talk about it in five dimensions. So, two dimensions, let's say your x is a vector, or in two dimensions it has x1, x2, and you have some points which are plus, some points which are minus. Clearly, they are nicely separated in this picture. And the linear threshold unit is the sine of b plus w1 x1 plus w2 x2, which is really this line, some line, right? That's the equation of a line. When I say sine of this, what's that? And the line, by sine, I mean that the line points in a certain direction. There is a slope, and one side of this line is defined to be positive, the other side is defined to be negative. Okay? Effectively, but remember that we only care about the sign. In some sense, what we are doing is, we have a line, this b plus w transpose x, and given a new point, we try to find the distance of that line from that point with the sign. If that distance is negative, the prediction is negative. The distance is positive, the prediction is positive. Okay? And in higher dimensions, the line in higher dimensions is a hyperplane. You can think of it in the following way. A hyperplane slices the space into two parts. Right? A line cuts across the space into and divides it into two parts. One of those parts becomes a positive, the other one becomes a negative. Which is convenient because for binary classification we have two labels. Questions about the geometry? If you've never seen this before, this might seem a little odd or weird or unnatural. But feel free to ask questions. Yes.
So if we just look at that as the equation of a line, in some sense we don't need W1 and W2, because for slope you only need, can't you just have one of them be 1 and then write W1?
Yeah, there
W2?
Are, right, you can, right, you can set one of those, you can divide that whole thing by, but let's say you do not have the bias term. Let's say the bias term is 0.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
Huh?
It's going to
go through the center.
It goes through the origin. Which restricts the kind number of lines that you can draw. In particular, if I have my minuses here and the pluses here, or the minuses here and the pluses here, no line through the center can divide. But you're right. This is slightly overspecified in that we only care about the sign, not the magnitude. And this is the only time probably I'll be talking about this in two dimensions. From now on, I'll almost always refer to this in D or N dimensions. And at that time, I'll be talking about W transpose X plus B, or W dot X plus B. Yes?
How do we choose W?
That's the job of the learning algorithm. So at this point, we are only going to talk, at least for most of today, we'll be talking about what can these kind of functions represent. And I guess the rest of probably the next many months or many weeks, we'll be picking it up. We'll look at least four or five different algorithms. And I'll point out that many popular learning algorithms that you might have seen actually have the same geometry, including the perceptron algorithm, naive Bayes is a linear classifier, logistic regression, some of you might have seen it, is a linear classifier, support vector machines have the same geometry, and each of these tries to find this W using slightly different ways. And we'll look at all these different ways for learning, and you can consider yourself as having reached the Zen state when you basically see that they're all so similar, even though they start off with very different assumptions. Other questions? It's very useful to keep this geometric intuition in mind, because especially when we come to the support vector machine and such and its variants, the geometry helps us get a good intuition of what's going on in the learning algorithm. So we'll be looking at this kind of a diagram with lines drawn across the plane quite a few times. There are no questions. I'm going to move on to the problem of what can we represent with a linear classifier. So what I've just described to you is a hypothesis space. There's no reason why it should be a good hypothesis space or a bad one. It's just a class of functions. So why is this class of functions so popular? It's probably the most dominant model for classification, the linear model. So there's a good reason for why it's popular. And one way to think about this is to think about what kind of Boolean functions can linear classifiers represent. It's an expressive hypothesis class. Many, many Boolean functions are linearly separable. Not all of them. In fact, there's a very interesting story about one of them that's not linearly separable, and I'll come to that eventually. Just to provide a counterpoint, decision trees can represent any Boolean function. A linear classifier can represent many Boolean functions. So let's look at one of them. A linear classifier can represent conjunctions and disjunctions. So if my function is x1 and x2 and x3, it's equivalent to that linear threshold unit. There are many ways of proving that. Probably the simplest way of proving that is just by writing down every possible input and output combination. So x1 plus x2 plus x3 should be more than 3. That's an AND. An AND says that the output is true if all of them are true. If all of them are true, the left-hand side of that will be 3. Even if one of them is false, the left-hand side will be less than 3. And here I've just enumerated. So for example, in this row here, the third from the bottom, x1 and x3 are true, x2 is false. The conjunction is false. That's the middle blue column. The sum of those three things is 2, which falls short of the right-hand side, so y prime is also false. And you can work through this if you want. Now, even negations are okay. I can have some of these literals negated. So x1 and x2 and not x3 is equivalent to that linear threshold unit, and you can prove it to yourself by staring at it and if you want, writing down this sort of a truth table.
Mm-hmm.
Disjunctions are also linearly separable. What that means is you can write down a line, an equation of a line that separates the true and the false for disjunctions, and it's a very good exercise for you. I think it will kind of give you an intuition of encoding Boolean functions as linear separators. Questions about this? Yes?
How can it be more than three?
It can only be, 3 is the upper limit there. You're right. I just wanted it to fit the definition of a linear threshold here. The threshold is either, basically that divides the space into two parts. It just so happens that on one part, there's exactly only one point.
And linear classifiers are only used for Boolean functions? And if there are more than...
No, you can have arbitrary real values. So nothing there says that X is, in fact, that's the other point. What if you have, you don't have a true Boolean, but a noisy version. So instead of X1 being 1, you can have, let's say, 0.9 or 1.1, a cluster around that group. And we'll see a picture of that in a bit.
No, I mean labels. Like, for example, your labels are 0 and
1. The labels are Boolean.
If we have more than 2 labels, like 1, 2, 3, so
right,
then
you,
can we use linear classifiers?
There are multi-class extensions for linear classifiers. So there are two. I heard two questions there, and I'll answer both of them. The first one is, what if your set of outputs is finite, but is one of a finite set of categories? So it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Only these 5 things. There are some rather easy to define multi-class extensions of linear threshold units. And sometime in the middle of the semester, we'll be looking at that. The other question I heard is, what if instead of a finite set of categories, if it is, the output can be a real number? Now that's regression. And we'll be looking at linear regression right after this. Yes?
They are more well defined than KNN.
What do you mean?
Because in KNN, on the boundary, we have to make a pick.
Here the boundary is
clearly defined.
Here the boundary is a simple boundary. That's a very good point. Remember that for k nearest neighbors, the boundary is not a single line. The boundary can be arbitrarily complex object. It can be a polynomial. Here the boundary is a single line. If you remember from nearest neighbors, we saw these decision boundaries which were rather complex. Same for, in fact, decision trees also. Yes?
In looking at that equation that you're claiming is equivalent to the conjunction,
yes,
it looks like the second to last row would be 1 plus 1 minus 0, which is 2, and the bottom would be 1 plus 1 minus 1, which is 1. We could classify them incorrectly.
Yes, there might be a mistake there. Okay, I'll fix it. In fact, that's another exercise. Find the mistake there. So, the thing is, most Boolean simple disjunctions and conjunctions, not most, all simple disjunctions and conjunctions are linearly separable. And the way to see that is, let's say I have a disjunction x1, just x1. Okay? My function is true when x1 is true. In two dimensions, you see this, there are 4 possible options. There is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. I can plot all these 4 points. Right? Only one of them is true. Actually, no, 3 of them are true. Right? Whenever x1 is true, 3 of them are true. Only the origin is false. So can I draw a line separating them? Now, this is an intuition that if I had a slide, it would be easier. So let me try to draw it right now. So this is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1, 1, and another point here. The disjunction x one, or this is hard. X two. Let me try to write this in a.
Yes. What about the black part?
The black. Thank you. So can people see all the way at the end if I write on this? And Bruce, you good? So this is 0, 0. Now the function that we want is x1 or x2, which gives a plus, 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 and a minus. To see that this is linearly separable, all you need to do is draw a line and say that this direction is plus. Right? I can draw multiple lines. I can draw this line. I can draw a line like this. There are many lines that separate the pluses from this one point. These three points are plus, and this one point is minus. So disjunctions, now to get the equation of this line, you now have to find the equation of this, you know, just figure out this the line here. Right? So x1 plus x2 equals a half. We'll separate these two. Now if you want x1 and not x2, and x1 is 1, so you get a plus here, and a when x2 is for true, you get a minus. Right? You get a plus here.
Minus.
You get a minus here. Is this linearly separable? Can you draw one line that separates the pluses from the minuses? Yes. Goes like this. So that's the, in two dimensions, it's the easy way of detecting linearly separable functions. Stare at it, and you get the answer. In high dimensions, as we know very well, you can't stare at it. Another class of functions that is linearly separable is the m of n function that we saw earlier. So just to remind you, the m of n function asks the following. There may be many, many input Boolean variables. So in this case, say x1 through x5, you pick up front n of them, say three of them, x1, x2, x3, and you say the output is true if at least m of them are true. If at least two of these particular three variables are true, then the output is true. This function is linear. How do you write two of x1, x1, x2, x3 as a linear function? People are whispering, so. What you have to do? Yes?
Well, I was going to say sum x1, 2, and 3 and see if they're greater than or equal to 2.
Yes, exactly. Does every, so the.
Assuming each value is 1.
Yeah. Because these are Boolean, you can say this function is. This linear threshold unit, x1 plus x2 plus x3 minus 2, the sign of that will give the same answer as that m of n function. Any questions about this? And this particular function is useful because it lets you build interesting models for things like, say, spam detection. If there are at least three of these particular words in your email, mark it as spam. But the nice thing about linear models is that you really don't have to care. You don't care. You just give, you treat it as a, because it's a linear model, because this hypothesis, this particular Boolean function can be represented by Boolean, by linear functions, you can just say, I don't care what the Boolean function is. I'm just going to give it to the learning algorithm. It will learn whatever it wants. I don't need to interpret it anymore. Okay? So now, the question is, this is nice, so you get a lot of these conjunctions, disjunctions, M of n functions, but the bad news is not all linear Boolean functions are linearly separable. The classic example is the XOR function, parity, which simply says if you have, which says count the number of ones in the input, count the number of truths. XOR is not linearly separable, and if you want to see that, you can just plot XOR on a graph just like that, and you get pluses here and minuses here, and we'll see that in a bit. So parity is not linearly separable, which is kind of an unfortunate thing because parity is such a commonly used concept. The other bit of bad news is that nearly all non-trivial Boolean functions are not linearly separable. Arbitrary conjunctive normal forms, things like this, x1 and x2 or x3 and not x4, is not a linear function in just in these four variables. And you have to do some additional tricks, use some additional tricks to make these linear. So to see that XOR is not linear, you can look at a data set that looks like this. This is an example of a data set which looks like a Boolean binary classification. Boolean sort of a function. If I assume that this cluster is minus 1, that's plus 1 and so on. So this is minus 1, for example, or 0, 0. So you cannot draw a line that slices this space and will give the right label for all points. Do people see that? Now this has an interesting history, and I'll probably mention this story again in the next lecture, but let me say it anyway. I think the linear classifiers came up, these are among the earliest models of prediction. They are vaguely modeled on the human neuron and things like that. And in the 1950s, I think 56, 57, maybe 58, Frank Rosenblatt developed the perceptron algorithm. He published a paper about it, and there was a press conference. Everyone said, okay, we are going to now solve AI in the next 2-3 years because we now have managed to get the brain, understand the human brain. In 1969, Marvin Minsky wrote a book where he basically said the perceptron cannot represent the XOR. If you can't do the XOR, then how can you model the brain? That's sort of an unfortunate point, because who said there's only one linear classifier involved? You can have, for example, draw two lines to slice up the space, but we're getting ahead of ourselves here. Any questions about XOR being not linearly separable? But the fact is, really, even these can be made linearly separable. Here's a neat trick. This is a data set in one dimension that is not linearly separable by a one-dimensional line. What's a one-dimensional line? A point. You cannot put a single threshold on this line and say everything to the right is plus, everything to the left is minus. But who said that you have to work in the representation that you are given with? You can always change it. And the trick is, you blow up the feature space. You represent every point here If you have a point x, you're represented in two dimensions by x, comma x squared. What that means, you go from this representation to something like this. And now, it's linearly separable. It's a neat trick. This trick is called blowing up the feature space. Who can tell me what's the problem with this trick? Yes?
You go too far, which gets permission to the recursive dimensionality.
Exactly. If you do this too many times, if I start off with 100 dimensional vectors and represent all possible pairs in addition to this 100 dimensional vectors, you have 100 square dimensions. That's how you get to these million dimensional vectors that I was telling you about. So, in fact, who said it has to be only squares? It can be arbitrary polynomials. So, effectively, this trick is equivalent to doing polynomial regression. You go from a linear space to a higher dimensional space. And now you make your classifier strictly more expressive. An exercise to you is, how do you make the XOR function, how do you apply this trick to the XOR function? I'm telling you that you can apply this trick to the XOR function and get a representation that is linearly separable. And I'll leave it to you to figure out. I'll tell you in the next class, I'll leave it to you to figure out how you can do it. Any questions about this idea of blowing up feature spaces and making functions linear, even though they are not linearly separable? And then there's another kind of problem that we might run into. Might get data that's almost linearly separable. There might be, because of noise, if there was no noise, the data might have been linearly separable, but because there is noise in the data becomes inseparable. But we'll live with that. So what we want are algorithms that can adjust for this noise and give us this parameter that says, I'm willing to live with this much noise. And hopefully it will be able to generalize across these things. So just to summarize this discussion about the expressivity of the linear classifier. Linear classifiers are expressive. Many Boolean functions can be represented as linear classifiers. Even some functions that cannot be represented as linear with the linear threshold unit can be forced into this regime using this blowing up trick and moving to another space where functions are linearly separable. And there are functions which are almost linearly separable, and we can just tolerate the noise because we know how to train linear classifiers. We have very robust algorithms. Okay? Any questions about the expressivity of linear classifiers? Before going ahead, I want to just mention this one thing about notation that I'll be using quite a bit in the slides in many of the lectures coming up, and you will probably see these in papers as well. So, remember that the linear threshold unit had a weight part and a bias term, a W and a B, and you add them up. This is equivalent to introducing a new feature which is multiplied with the B. That feature is always 1. So you move from X to, you add one more feature to it, X, 1. You move from the D dimensional space to the D plus 1 dimensional space. And you just put the b into the weight vector and you call it w prime. So the advantage of this is that now we can talk about sine of w dot x or w prime dot x prime, which is equivalent to b plus wx. So we get these lines or hyperplanes that pass through the origin in this higher dimensional space. This is just syntactic sugar or mathematical, just notational sugar. It gives you nothing, it just makes it. Makes your equations look have fewer terms in it. So it lets you write down the math becomes slightly simpler. That's the only reason to do it. But I want you to always remember that when you're training a classifier, you have a bias term. There is always a bias term. And if you don't have a bias term, if the bias is zero, that means you're only looking at hyperplanes that pass through the origin, and that restricts your search space. This is a point that even people who've been doing this for a very long time tend to forget. They forget to put a bias term in, and then they worry, they wonder why their classifier is not working. So just keep, even though we might write just w dot x, there's always a bias term involved. Okay, is this clear?
I have a question. So you can combine a sequence of linear functions with a linear function, but if you combine a sequence of linear functions combined with non-linear functions, then you get non-linear functions. And in fact, you can get anything.
Sure.
So
what you're talking about is a collection of piecewise linear functions. A functions that are piecewise linear. You're talking about functions that are piecewise linear.
Yes.
Yes.
My question is there any gain if you use instead of linear functions, non-linear functions, let's say compare it, and you still use some highly non-linear functions?
The problem with getting to highly non-linear functions, and this is something that we'll talk about, typically all the learning algorithms that we'll have for linear functions, their generalization guarantee is a function of the dimensionality of the data, the dimensionality of the classifier. If your function is highly nonlinear, it's equivalent to being a linear classifier in a much higher dimensional space. And so learning those classifiers in a provably correct way becomes more of a nightmare. You need way more data to fit that. So the trade-off with increasing the dimensionality wildly is that you gain more expressivity, but learning becomes hard. In the hypothesis spaces version of the story, you can think of it this way. The number of nonlinear functions is much more than number of linear functions. So search becomes hard because you have to search through more functions. Does that answer your question? Okay, keep thinking about it, and once we get to these theorems about learning algorithms, you might be able to, we'll revisit that question. Okay, so let me just wind up this discussion about expressivity, and with a couple of exercises that I mentioned, just to test your own understanding. Try to represent disjunctions. Just pick a small disjunction and try to represent it as a linear function. Convince yourself that I'm not lying. And the other thing is apply this blowing up trick to the XOR function and see that XOR can be made linear if we move to a blown up feature space. The hint is the space has to be quadratic. All you need is a quadratic space. And convince yourself that XOR becomes linear in that space. And I'll mention the answer to this same something like that. Okay, so where are we? We looked at linear classifiers. What are linear classifiers? We looked at the fact that they are an interesting hypothesis class, and it's good to study them because they can express a lot of functions. Now let's take a detour. Let's go from the classification world to the regression world, because we no longer, in regression, the interesting thing is we no longer have thresholds. There is no discrete, there are no discontinuous or non-differentiable functions, and we can apply calculus and basically derive a learning algorithm in the next 20 minutes. And you might have seen variants of this, what I'm going to talk about, in maybe stats classes for some other pieces, for linear algebra even. The problem can be phrased in many ways. So let's say you're given some data where you've given the weight of a car and its age, and you're supposed to predict its mileage. And this is just some data that I made up based on some four Google searches. And you have these four examples, and we want a function that can predict that last call given the weight and the age. And one strategy that you can take to do this is to use linear regression. The idea being that you model the output variable, the mileage, as a linear function of the inputs plus a bias. And here I'm using W0 to represent the bias just to drive home the point that you can fold it into the W's. Okay? Now, remember that this is not classifier, this is regression. We are predicting real valued output. So, just this W.x is the mileage. So, now the task of learning is given a data set, find the best for whatever that means, the best set of W's for this data set. Once learning is done, prediction is easy. Just take the dot product. This is the game we are playing right now in linear regression. Okay? And the W's are called the weights. They form a vector, in this case a three-dimensional vector. In general, and I'll be calling, this is the weight vector. In general, inputs are real valued vectors in RD, and outputs are also real valued because this is regression. And we have m training examples of inputs paired with outputs, xi and yi. And we want to approximate that y as a linear function defined using these weights. And that should have been xdwt. So we want to say, we want to find a weight vector w such that the y is w dot x. And notice that I'm using this trick of putting the folding the bias into the weight vector here by assuming that there is always one feature, x1, which is constant. That way there's a bias term, but still I can live with this representation of w dot x rather than w dot x plus b. There's always a bias term. And now the job of learning is to find this d-dimensional weight vector w. Just to make this slightly concrete, you're given examples of this kind. This is the one-dimensional version of the story. You're given x1 and a y, and your job is to find a line that kind of approximates this thing, and given a new point on this x space, you'll find the new, you can predict the y. But notice that this is a modeling choice that we've made. There's nothing that tells us that this data is linear. We have decided to approximate this data as a linear function. We could have chosen a polynomial. We could have chosen a quadratic. We could have chosen a higher degree polynomial. For reasons of, for various reasons that involve generalization and basically not overfitting this data, we have chosen to represent, to use, to only consider the search space of linear functions. In two dimensions, you may have data points like this, and your job is now to find a plane. Again, you predict a y for a new point as w1 plus w2 x2 plus w3 x3. Okay? Any questions about this? What's the one thing that's missing here? Prediction is easy.
Error rate.
I can't, who's?
Your error rate, how accurate it is.
Oh, that's actually a much, much more difficult question. There's an easier question that's missing.
What are the optimal weights?
What are the optimal weights? How do you get the W's? I just told you that you can get these W's. In fact, the question of how good this is, takes slightly more work. The question of how to find the optimal weights can be done in the remaining time today. So how do you find the best weight vector? In fact, what does it mean to be the best weight vector? What does best mean in this case? And let me define, in this case, if I have a weight vector w, and there is a training example xi, yi, I'm going to define the cost of a mistake on that particular example as the difference between the prediction, which is w dot x, and the true label, y, and the absolute value, the absolute distance, as the absolute difference. Okay? So this is the cost of making one mistake. And what is generally a very good learning strategy, not just here, but we'll come, this is a strategy that we'll keep employing again and again, is to define a cost of a mistake or something called loss of one example, and then define the loss of a weight vector using that cost. The loss of a weight vector, or the cost of one weight vector, is the total cost on the entire data set. I've squared it so that we can, it's an easier function to optimize. So you have the cost of one example is y minus wx, and you add them all up, and this is the squared error on the training set that a w makes. The sum of squared errors of the training set is a good objective to minimize. And that's the strategy that we'll use. Find the best weight vector by minimizing this function, by finding the w that has the least cost. This is called least mean squares regression. And the name basically gives away the whole objective. Least mean squares, or least mean squared error. There are, this is one of the oldest studied problems in regression, and I suspect some of you may have seen this in many other, in other places before, but for what it's worth, I'm going to go through the gory details of this, mostly because the algorithm that we'll end up deriving will look very similar to other learning algorithms that we'll see through the semester. So it's good to actually get through the details of something that is not terribly difficult, or that can be fit on one slide, where the math can be fit on one slide. There are many different ways of learning, and probably the most common, given, okay, so now the strategy here is I've got an objective and I'm going to define learning by minimizing the total loss, and the most common way of doing this is by using gradient descent. Gradient descent is a popular learning strategy when you want to minimize, but just as a side note, for this, just this particular objective, you can actually work out the solution on paper, and I'll, at the end of today's lecture, I'll probably show you another exercise question which makes you do that. But let's talk about gradient descent. How many people have seen gradient descent before? About half, I would say. Here's an intuition. You have a function, some function. Yes?
I have a question on the.
Can you speak up?
I have a question on the least mean square.
Yeah.
So if it's mean, then it has to be like 1 by n, right?
Right, but that's a constant, right? You're minimizing. So it is 1 over m. There's a divide by m, but m is constant. So you might as well throw it out. I have the half there because the calculus becomes easier. That's the only reason. If you have an M, sure, you can have an M. You'll carry it around everywhere and it just makes the math uglier. So, say you're given a function J, some function, and you want to minimize, find the minimum value. The general idea in gradient descent is the following. You start off with some initial point, W naught. You find the gradient of this function at that point, and the gradient is really the direction of steepest increase of that function. And you want to minimize it, so you do the most obvious thing, which is go away from that direction. You're trying to get to the bottom of the hill, you go in the opposite direction of the steepest increase. And you keep doing that till you get to the bottom. What that means is we start off with some W naught, find the gradient at that point, go in the opposite direction, find the gradient again, take one more step, keep doing this till you get to the bottom. And the theory of optimization says if your function is convex, remember convexity from homework zero.
Yeah.
Excellent. So a function is convex if basically it looks like a ball. It has a single minimum and all the gradients, and there is a formal mathematical definition of it. It's in your homework zero, the question in your homework zero, but I'll be working through that when we need convexity. I'll be talking about convexity in more detail, but the theory says if your function is convex, gradient descent will find the answer, the minimum. So let's apply this idea for least mean squares. Remember that the function we want to minimize is that thing on the top, the least, the mean square error. And you basically just apply this idea. Initialize a W0, any W0. And the nice thing about this objective is it is actually convex, so the initialization point doesn't matter. So initialize your W0 and then iterate over many time steps. First, compute the gradient at WT. I've called that Nabla J. And then take an update. Go, so this is your gradient. Take a small step of size r in the opposite direction of the gradient. R is called the learning rate. And invariably, that will be the one parameter that you will end up tweaking when you are implementing this algorithm. And so what's missing here? This is, I've got the whole algorithm here. Remember that these are vectors. W's are vectors. This guy is a vector. So what is stopping you from implementing this right now?
Computing the gradient.
Good.
Like magic happened.
Yes. So what's the gradient of J? Remember that J is a function from a vector to a scalar. You take the partial derivatives. So the gradient of J is a collection of partial derivatives of that with respect to all the each dimension. So you have d dimension, so you have d partial derivatives. So it's that vector. And all you have to do is compute the partial derivatives, which is easy, right? Let's just work through the thing. Let's just go through the details. So, it's easy if you are willing to stare at enough math. The function we want to optimize is half sum of the error. Let's take the partial derivative of that with respect to one of the W's, Wj. Now, the thing is, summation doesn't really matter, so you can move the partial derivative inside, right? Now you can apply the chain rule. You have what's the derivative of a square? It's 2 times that times the derivative of that thing inside. So it's 2 times that error times the derivative of a linear thing. This is a line. Only one of these W's is in play here. Just the Wj, just this Wj is in play. All these other things with respect to Wj are constants. So they disappear. So you're left with a rather simple expression. And if you clean up all the minuses and get rid of the 2, you get a partial derivative looks like this. It's the sum over all the data. By the way, this, just to clarify, this is just one element in that partial derivative. You need to do this d times, one for each dimension. But this has a very interesting form. It's the sum of the error times the input. Okay? And I just want you to observe that this has this form, because eventually when we come to other learning algorithms, they have some rather similar looking expressions. Questions about And if you've never seen this before, this might look like too much math on one slide. If you've seen this before, this might look like too much detail on one slide.
Yeah.
Either way, it's good to stare at.
When does this algorithm stop? Like you said, it repeats for some time. Like
you repeat till you find that the changes that you make are very small. The change in the objective.
Huh?
You have an input to the program.
So this input, that's just an input in one of the dimensions?
One of the dimensions of the input.
The one I'm interested in?
Yes. No, not that you're interested in. You're
well,
doing that for every...
Right, in this derivative's perspective.
Yes. Yeah. I'll let you stare at this for 10 seconds. Like I said, if you've never seen it before, it's good to stare at it. Yes?
So does that mean we are minimizing that error?
Taking a step in this direction will go towards smaller errors. Will take you towards a W that gives a smaller error for this data set. And you take more and more steps in this. You take a step, you compute the gradient at the new point, and take another step. So that's a good segue for looking at the algorithm again. So you initialize W0, and then you evaluate the gradient at step T, at WT, basically by performing this calculation. And this is, remember, this is just one element of the gradient. And you make an update. Now you are at WT plus 1, which is WT minus R gradient. And you've taken a step away from the steepest increase. You go to WT plus 1. You repeat this same gradient step again. For how long? There are many ways of deciding how long this loop should run. One way of doing that is to say you give an input of, you decide that I'm going to run this for 10 steps. How do you get 10? You just try 10. Which is, unfortunately, the more common way of doing things. The more principled way of doing things is you keep track of the value of the function, the j, that you're minimizing at each step. You keep compute j of wt and j of wt plus 1, and if you decide that that change is too small, then you just stop. And once again, r here is the learning rate. It's a small constant. And as I said, the objective is convex, so this algorithm will converge to the global minimum, independent of what W0 is. Any questions? Yes?
Just to clarify, we have M training examples here?
You have M training examples. And the dimensionality of each vector here is D. Okay, let's stare at this step a little more. Notice that you have to sum over every example before taking a single step. So to take one, make one update of the weight vector, you need to make an entire pass over the data set. And only then can you get your gradient, because the gradient is defined to be the sum over all the examples. That raises the question of, can I make updates to the weight vector as and when I see errors? I take a training example, I notice that my current weight vector is terrible, let me just update it. Instead of summing over the entire data set, waiting for everything to show up, all the errors to accumulate, and then update it. This style of gradient descent is called the batch gradient descent, where you sum over the entire data set. The contrast is something called stochastic gradient descent or incremental gradient descent, where what you do is you pick a random example, x, y, and you pretend that this single example is the entire training set you have at that point. Compute the gradient, take a step. Now take another random example and do this. So that's the stochastic part. You pick a random example, take a gradient step. and you keep iterating. And the nice thing about stochastic gradient descent is that your weight vector keeps getting updated much, much faster. So empirically, and also there's some math behind this, which it shows there's this kind of an update rule. If your data set is really large, this tends to converge faster, because very often the number of updates that you make will be much, much more, because you're making one update for every example, but you'll very quickly get to a very good weight vector. Instead of actually waiting for a full pass and then making an update and then waiting for another full pass before making an update, somewhere before that you will probably get done. I wanted to contrast this with the batch version, where you have to wait for the entire data set to go through. So let me give you the more procedural version of this algorithm. So again, it looks very similar. There are very subtle differences. You iterate multiple times over the training set. You pick one training example, pretend that it's the entire training set, and take a gradient step. That's the gradient step. The only thing missing is you don't have a summation. So updates keep, the updates happen much earlier. And interestingly, this update rule is one of the earlier learning algorithms that showed up in the neural networks literature. The neural networks were, this is called the Widrow-Hof rule. And it was implemented back, I don't know, in the 12th century BC or something, in hardware. So, stochastic gradient descent has made a significant resurgence in the machine learning world. And if you ask me now, this is the algorithm I would implement for not this objective, but for other objectives, simply because it's such an easy algorithm to implement. You should be able to implement this algorithm right now, because all you need is this one primitive, the dot product. And you need a way of managing vectors. And how do we implement vectors? You can use arrays, lists, or whatever of numbers. That's all you need. So you can implement this algorithm right now. And it does surprisingly well, and it's really fast, which is excellent. Questions about stochastic gradient descent? Yes?
So, I know maybe this is going beyond the scope of what we're talking about, but we talked about this is primarily used for convex functions.
Yeah.
So we have the problem of finding the local minima.
Yes.
Right, the optimal local.
Yes.
So
what do you do when your function is not convex?
That's the question.
For the scope of this class, we'll only be looking at convex objectives. But the fact is, out there in the real world, you end up having to write objective functions that are not convex. And there are certain classes of non-convex functions for which we know how to get with guarantees to the local minimum. There are algorithms for that. In the worst case, there's nothing you can do. One strategy that is completely unprincipled but is widely employed is, if you have a function, you can compute the gradient, go down the gradient. But no guarantees there. One of the important, one big push that has existed in machine learning has been to think of non-convex functions and try to find approximations of them using convex functions, so that the minimum of the global minimum of that wild function that you care about is also the global minimum of a convex function. And then you minimize the surrogate. As you might imagine, that's not a trivial job. It requires a lot of some rather clever tricks and doesn't always apply. So in the worst case, all bets are off. As far as this class is concerned, we'll almost entirely be looking only at convex functions. I think the only time we look at non-convex objectives is when we talk about the EM algorithm. And even there, the trick is to get a surrogate that's convex and keep approximating upon it with a convex function.
Is that a situation where you could try something like a point-to-swarm optimization technique?
Again, no guarantees.
Well, obviously.
You can try a lot.
But you can like better.
One algorithm that is actually more studied in this ballpark is simulated algorithm, where you try to go down the minimum, and occasionally you just take these jumps. Hopefully, it will take you, if you're stuck in a local minimum, it will take you out of there. And the probability of these jumps keeps getting lower and lower as learning progresses, so that you start narrowing down. But I'm not going to talk about simulated learning too much. Okay, since there's only 1 minute left, I just want to talk about learning rates. Generally, the rule of thumb is pick a small learning rate. And if the learning rate decreases over time and converges to zero at infinity, you're guaranteed to converge with some other conditions, which are almost always satisfied. Learning rate is also called the step size. And the important thing I want you to take home is this idea of gradient and stochastic gradient descent. Even though we are only talking about regression, the same two algorithms will keep showing up for classification algorithms as well, which is why I went through this in a lot of detail. Okay? So, just to summarize, for regression, we want to predict real valued output. And linear regression is a case when we regress to a line. And we looked at gradient and stochastic gradient descent. This is an important an interesting point just for this particular case. Just for this objective, you can write down the objective as a matrix optimization problem, which is what I'll, if you go to the slides online, you'll be walking through, if you're comfortable with matrix or vector calculus. It can be shown that there is this particular matrix, which can be created from your training data. For that matrix, the best weight vector that you can create, that according to that minimizes the loss, is defined using this expression. Mm-hmm. And if you can walk through this, and we'll pick it up in the next lecture. All right, I'll stop now, and I'll be around if there are questions. I just want to remind you guys to send me your project information, and please do take advantage of office hours.